Everyone, and thank you for being here for the 80th urban workshop of this series. And we're very pleased to welcome today Thomas Crowley, who will present the Ridge and the City Environmental Politics in Delhi. So just a little bit about Thomas before starting. He is the author of the report Fractured Forests, the Political Ecology of the Delhi Ridge, which he wrote while working for the Delhi-based NGO Intercultural Resources. Beginning in October, he will be a fellow at the Art, Science and Business program at the Academic School Solitude in Stuttgart, Germany. So thank you, Thomas, for being here with us, and we'll let you go. So a 45-minute presentation followed by a series of questions and answers. Thank you.
Thank you, Christine, and thank you for the organizers, CPR and CSH, Marie-Helene and Puerto. It's a pleasure to be here, and I'm happy to talk about this topic. So basically today I'll be talking about the Delhi Ridge, and I've been researching this on and off for the past 5 years, and the presentation I'm giving today is part of a much larger research project that's looking at trying to retell the story of Delhi as a long sort of political capital, and retelling that history through the ridge. Today I'll focus a bit more on the, well, relatively recent history, colonial period onwards, and specifically the kind of politics of the ridge, and politics not just in the sense of what the government is doing, although that's also part of it, but politics in terms of who controls what land, how are those fights over the land played out in terms of on the ground what's happening, and then also what ideas are put forward, how is this land imagined. So both conceptually and materially, and I would argue these two are related, so how the ridge has been seen has affected how the actual changes of the land. So the first question, of course, is what is the ridge? I mean, those of you from Delhi would probably know about it. When I came to Delhi in 2010, I heard about the ridge from friends, from newspaper articles, environmental reports, stuff like that. And I started out knowing, I mean, reading those things, I thought I knew what the ridge was, and then the more I read, the more uncertain I became what actually is the ridge. I realized there was also a lot of confusion, even among the people who should know what it is, say the Delhi Forest Department. So the first part of the presentation, I'll just talk a little bit about what is the ridge and what are those conflicting definitions. And I think that's important, not just because we should know what we're talking about if we're having a talk on the ridge, but those different definitions and those fights over different definitions suggest something about the history of the ridge and suggest something about how it's developed over time, and suggest various other things beyond just, you know, what's in a name. And so what I kind of discovered in my research and hope to bring out today a bit is that often when people talk about environment in Delhi, they won't talk about history. When they talk about history, they won't talk about the environment. When they talk about the environment, they won't talk about politics, and vice versa. So I'm trying to bring these things together a little bit in my talk. So again, starting out with definitions. So one is just to take the name itself, ridge. So it's geological. I mean, the term is from geology. So if we want to look at the ridge as geology, which is often how it's presented, so it's the northern edge of the Aravalli mountain range. So for this presentation, for the most part, I'll be sticking to Delhi, meaning national capital territory, in terms of, I mean, that has a lot of impact on, for instance, laws, government bodies, and all of that. I will talk a little bit about the Haryana bit, but mostly I'll be sticking to Delhi. So this is a map of NCT, and it's this is a soil composition map. And the red bit the dark red is the ridge. The ridge in the sense it's the Aravallis. So the Aravallis are a very old mountain chain, 1.5 billion years old, and they stretch from Gujarat to here. This is the end. So that little bit just, you know, to the left of the Yamuna is the end of the Aravallis, or the beginning. So this is a very straightforward definition. It's a mountain range. It's made mostly of quartzite. This is the end of it. So this is the ridge. But then generally, if you read the newspapers, environmental reports, usually, and the sentence I keep on coming across is, the ridge is the green lung of Delhi. So, I mean, green lung doesn't, I mean, logically have anything to do with a mountain range. So, okay, but that's the definition. And when people talk about saving the ridge, they're not talking about saving some, like, quartzite stones. They're talking about saving a forest. So this is a second definition, which is to see the ridge as a forest. This is also a map of NCT. And this is actually from the draft of the master plan that's still currently under review. I believe it's for 2020. And so this is the DDA's proposed plan, land use plan. So residential would be marked in one color, and industrial in another, and commercial, and so on. What we're interested in is the dark green, which you'll see at the bottom, sort of bottom right. Not the light green, but the dark green. And then there's bits of it a bit further north. Does this? So this is clearly the biggest bit, and it comes up here. So this is one, and then there's this. We're somewhere around here, I think, and this. So, and that dark green is reserved forest. So reserved forest is the highest level of protection that the state can give to a forest land. So that's the second definition. And I would argue that that is the more kind of crucial definition when it comes to policy, when it comes to fights over the land. Even though the geology may be more foundational, this ecological definition is the one that has weight in political kind of fights and contestations. So these are the two put together. And you'd probably notice that they largely cover the same territory. Obviously, there's a strong correspondence, but not exactly. There are some parts that are on the ecological map that aren't on the geological map, and vice versa. But actually, largely, it's the geological part is much bigger. So the geological part covers about 15% of Delhi. This part is less than that. So for instance, this is like Nehru Place, the ISKCON Mandir, or something like that, is all in this. None of this is reserved forest. All of these parts, basically between central and south Delhi, this is all hill, but it's not reserved forest. And then on the other hand, you have like little patches in here, which are not actually. Anyway, you get the point.
What's the sort of slightly ochre color, lighter thing?
This here.
Yeah.
So this is these are alluvial deposits. So basically, this is all. Sorry, not alluvial. There's another term that's basically windswept, if there's any geologists in the audience. These are basically sands that have been blown in by the wind. And some geologists think that actually they've come as far as the Thar Desert over time, and they've kind of gotten trapped because this is a basin that's created by the Aravallis. So this is alluvial soil, all of this stuff. This is not alluvial soil, this is this windswept, there's some technical term for it. Basically, this is sand and thin soil that's been blown in by the wind. So it's not as fertile, basically. And it's there because, I mean, it's been trapped by the basin created by the Aravallis. So So what's interesting is if you ask the forest department, they'll say that basically everything is the ridge. They'll say that anything that's geologically the ridge is the ridge. Anything that's reserved forest is the ridge. So I mean, they say that because they may as well kind of overestimate. I mean, they may as well say, okay, everything, this is all. But in terms of actually legally binding, I mean, if you're taking this to court or something, the reserved forest is actually actually what matters. I mean, you can say, you know, you can say that Nehru Place is on the ridge, but no one's going to litigate a case to say that you should, you know, make this into a forest or something like that. So obviously the question comes about, I mean, one is why is there a forest on the ridge? I mean, if you just think totally logically without thinking about history and Delhi's growing and all, this would be the least fertile part of Delhi. I mean, it's stone, soil, I mean, it's thin soil. The trees that naturally grow on it are not the hardiest, biggest trees. So why did Delhi end up with its forest on the least fertile part of it? I mean, that's one question. The other question is, why is it called the ridge? It's not really a ridge. I mean, there's hills, tablelands, sort of rolling hills in different places. So these are all questions that I sort of, as my research went on, started asking myself, and basically realized that the answers are, you have to look historically at the ridge. And also, I mean, the ridge is an English word. Even something as basic as that. So in Hindi, it's called pahadi. I mean, it's just called hills. There's no, like, special term for it. So why is it called the ridge in English? Especially if it's not all a ridge. So then that's when... I mean, I wasn't initially interested in the history. I mean, I do find Delhi's history interesting, but I didn't think it was something I was going to explore a lot. The more my research went on, the more and more it became historical. Because I do feel, especially for the ridge, and especially in a city like Delhi that has so much history, this is really, really crucial. So I started to do a sort of genealogy of the ridge. So this picture is a very famous picture. It was taken, I believe, in 1858, after the uprising. This... I don't know, was it an Italian photographer? Anyway, came and took a lot of pictures. This is from the Northern Ridge, what we now call the Northern Ridge. This is Flagstaff Tower. So basically, I mean, during the uprising, the rebels basically took control of the cantonment and forced out the British troops. And so the British troops and all their families had to flee, and they, an afternoon, they were stuck in this Flagstaff Tower. It's the highest point on the Northern Ridge. And then when the British came back, they camped out basically on the ridge. And when there was a huge siege of Delhi, basically the British were on the ridge. The rebels were in the city. And there was a lot of fighting between the two. Anyway, I mean, that's a big, long story. But the important part is that this is when the ridge started being referred to as the ridge. I mean, not just a ridge, but the capital V ridge. And it was only this bit. So if I can go back here. The ridge, I mean, when the British were saying the ridge, they just meant this, which actually is a ridge. So, I mean, that answers one question. So that was easy. We got that out of the way quickly. So this for the British in 1857, this was the ridge, or this, and same thing. And it had a lot of, almost religious, importance. It became a sacrosanct place, because it was seen as this place where the British had sacrificed, where they'd laid down their lives to preserve the empire, all of those things. So now there's, after that, the British built this mutiny memorial, which I don't know if you've seen it. It's this, like, very garish sort of cathedral spire, which is very close to here. So it became almost this sort of sacred ground. And so people in London would know what the ridge was. And they would know the great sacrifices, I mean, that the British soldiers made on the ridge. Yes. So that's where it began. Then, so fast forward to 1911, so then the British shift the capital from Calcutta to Delhi, and then they spend a lot of time trying to decide, okay, where are we going to build the new city? So you had, this is Shahjahanabad. Well, not all of it. This bit here is Shahjahanabad. So, those of you from Delhi, I'm sure, know this story. I mean, initially they thought maybe we can build it here, above where civil lines is now and still was then. For various reasons, they decided against it. One of the reasons was they said we can't build on the northern ridge because it's basically sacred. I mean, British public won't like it if we build a bunch of buildings in this space. So they were looking at other locations, and they chose, obviously, Rashtrapati Bhavan, which is here, ish. So why did they choose to site? I mean, then it was the Viceroy's Lodge, or whatever, Viceregal. So why did they choose to site it there? I mean, it's on what we now call the ridge. So they called it then the Southern Ridge. So again, tracing the shifting names, originally this was just the ridge. Then this became the Northern Ridge, and this became the Southern Ridge from 1911 onwards. So, with the Southern Ridge, they decided on it for several reasons, and these also have to do with it being the ridge. One is the very simple fact that it's elevated. So, if you're trying to build a grand empire, and building New Delhi was specifically to show the grandeur of the empire, I mean, to show the power, and also to try to tap into the history of Delhi as a city, as a political capital historically, the Mughals, the Sultans. So basically from on high of Rashtrapati Bhavan, you could see Jama Masjid, you could see Humayun's tomb, you could see Safdarjung's tomb. So the idea was that you're showing continuity with these sites, but you're also literally and metaphorically above them. You're taking on their legacy, but you're bringing it forward, you're bringing it higher. Also for very practical reasons, it was a good choice. It was less malarial, basically, than the North Delhi site. And that's also because the water basically drains well from the ridge. The other is that it's cheap. So you can't do this is very important for the history of the ridge. You can't do agriculture on it. Or you can, but you can't really do it very well. So historically, the ridge has not been agriculturally productive. So the land is cheaper. So, I mean, this is all very well documented in the archives. They keep on saying, cost, we shouldn't worry about cost. This is a very, this is for the pride of the empire. But, it's a lot cheaper, so we should consider this. And the other was a military reason. So the new camp is here, I believe. I believe that's what these crosshairs are. So the idea was that basically you have the ridge, and on the one side you have the Viceregal building, and on the other side you have the cantonment. So they're connected, but they have some distance. So for a variety of reasons, the British decided to make this the center. Then in 1913, so what's interesting is, the ridge doesn't get really, the city doesn't really get built until the 30s. But in 1913, when construction hasn't even really started, the area behind the central ridge, this bit, was named a reserve forest. This is very old, and this is in fact even before the Indian Forest Act that is in effect now is 1927. So this is before that, an earlier version, 1878. So this was, quite early in the history of the Forest Act, Indian Forest Act. And so again, it's not that the British were very concerned about the ecosystem of the ridge. For them, they said that, look, this really doesn't look good, because at that time it was barren. Also, this is the northern ridge, but you get an idea. There's one tree there, and that's it. And so the central ridge would have also looked like this. A few trees, some shrubs. So the ridge would have been very barren, relatively barren then. And so basically when they were planning to build Rashtrapati Bhavan, they were saying, you know, this doesn't look very good. It's this gray, dusty stone. It's very drab. And if we're going to have this, you know, center of the empire here, how can it look like this? And so there were a lot of back and forth between forest department officials and city planners saying, okay, what can we plant? How can we basically make a nice backdrop for the new city? So then they were trying out different plants. They didn't do a very good job. That's a whole other story. But that's basically when the sort of replantation of the ridge happened. And just 2 years after that, in 1915, they also reserved this bit, the Northern Ridge. So it was first the what the British called the Southern Ridge, and then 2 years later, what they called the Northern Ridge. And actually, again, this is very much related to the history. I mean, to the history. So basically, when they were planning the city, they said, okay, we should also build all these roads, basically going from the Mutiny Memorial to the new capital. So they built very nice roads, and the idea was that visiting dignitaries and all would be able to ride and see this nice view, and that also it should all be forested, so it shouldn't be such a drab view. So they should have a nice view, and they should be able to drive. And they also, interestingly, built very nice roads from here to Qutb Minar, which is, again, another spot you can see from there. So these were the early sort of notifications. So then the question that I started to ask is, I mean, what was this before? So the British decided, okay, it's a place for a capital, we're going to make it a forest. But that's only like part of the story. And that's the bits that they were immediately interested in. But like, what was the ridge before that? So again, this is going a bit further back into history. And actually the reason we know about this, or at least the reason we can read about it in English, is because of the British. So if you look at the initial settlement reports for when the British came, basically, I mean, 1803, the British take control of Delhi. And after that, they bring out several settlement reports, which is basically, again, about money. It's trying to say what taxes can you levy on what land. But the settlement reports have all sorts of other things. I mean, it's sort of like amateur anthropology. They're talking about, you know, the Gujars are like this, but the Jats are like this, and the Brahmins are like this, and very colonial kind of anthropology. So, a fascinating source also. So you get a sense of what the landscape was like before the British came. And again, the key thing here is the ridge is not a good place for doing agriculture. So, I mean, Delhi has been a city it's been a major political capital since the, you know, 1200s. Earlier than that, there was stuff, but in terms of actually being a very key political center, that's only with the Sultanate. Prithviraj Chauhan had a fort here, but it was not the center of his kingdom. It was kind of something he had. Anyway, so you have, you know, now almost a millennium of history. So this is not going to be a pristine landscape. You hear people say that we should protect, actually the current master plan says we should protect the ridge in its pristine glory, but that's just sort of rhetoric. No environmentalist would actually seriously say it's pristine. And it's precisely because you've had a millennium of history in this area, urban history. So with urban history, with a city, obviously you need to feed the population. So how does land get divided up in Delhi? Basically, the ridge is used for pastoralism. I mean, it's used for grazing. It's also used for collecting firewood. Not huge amounts of it, but so you would have these woodlots. And then non-ridge land would be used for agriculture, basically. So, I mean, this is, so during sort of the peak of Shah Jahanabad, when it's most populous, there's something like 10 kilometers on any side of the city was intensive agriculture. And so you get an idea of the kind of amount of agriculture that had to be done to feed the city. And again, the ridge would be where, would be also generally commonly owned land. So you'd have villages around Shah Jahanabad. The ridge land would either be common parts of within a village or between two villages, commonly owned land. Also, you would have sacred groves in some spots. So you'd have these three, and woodlot. So basically, you have wood there, but you're using it specifically for firewood. By the later Mughal period, then you do have denuded landscapes. I mean, like this, because of urban pressures. You have huge urban pressures. So you also have this kind of degradation that would have started during the Mughal period. The other thing that you have happening during once the British come is they're really pushing very hard for intensive agriculture over pastoralism. And this is through taxes, this is through various kind of land settlements. It's also ideological, and they're basically saying that pastoralists are not to be trusted. A lot of them are put under the Criminal Tribes Act, basically because they're generally nomadic, harder to control. There's a history of, sort of rebellion, banditry, all of that kind of stuff. So there's a big drive when the British come in to privatize the commons and to push intensive agriculture, which also has negative impacts on the ridge. Negative impacts in terms of these woodlots would kind of get squeezed out of existence, pastoral livelihoods would get squeezed. So basically it's this conversion from commonly held lands used for a variety of purposes to, on the one hand, private plots, and the other hand, state-owned pieces of land. So it's going from basically, what you have now is this, you have either public or private land. Earlier was a very different kind of system. And forest is one part of it, but it's not just forest. So this is, again, where the geology comes back in. So it's not there very much now in the discourse about the ridge, but for a very long time, the geology of the ridge was absolutely crucial. So one is, if you look at any of the old ruins of Delhi, they're all made out of quartzite, and which is all from the ridge. So Tukulukabad, all the ruins in Mehrauli. And also, more recently, you have the... Basically, when quartzite erodes, it disintegrates, it creates sand, which is the Badarpur sand. So this is used in the local construction industry, and it's really, really valuable. Valuable in the sense, not that it's costly, but valuable in the sense it's extremely useful because it's a locally available product and you use it for cement, use it for concrete, use it for laying foundations. So there's a huge, huge need for this for construction. So actually when the British were building New Delhi, they built a special tram line that went from Badarpur to central Delhi. And it was just bringing quartzite and sand basically for building the new city. And at that time, it was the biggest, they had the biggest storehouse of stone in the world was there in Delhi. So in huge, huge, huge quarrying operations. And these continued post-independence.
Do you have a sense of where this quarrying took place from that?
So it used to happen everywhere, basically. So when they were building New Delhi, there's a reference to mines in Jandewalan. Also Badarpur, because Badarpur was just the biggest available one. Jandewalan would be here-ish. Badarpur would be here. After independence, the mining industry was largely along the southern belt, because this part all became urbanized, basically. So after independence, basically all along from Kalpasera to Badarpur, wherever there was, quarries available, there was quarrying happening. And basically this is a village-based industry. That time, post-independence and even through probably the 70s, 80s, this really was rural. I mean, it felt like that. It was in NCT, but it was the rural part of NCT. So you had this huge kind of quarrying industry where it was basically, and this is again why the history is important, basically the most powerful communities in most of these villages were Gujar. So this is a community that's traditionally pastoralist. And they, earlier in history, were nomadic, became settled. Partially that's like forceful settlement by the British. And they became the dominant cast in these villages. So basically they would get contracts, and until very recently, I mean, any quarrying that happens, the government owns basically the underground. Very recently that was, or relatively recently that was changed. But so you have to get a contract from the government. So basically a lot of, like, basically powerful village, I mean, panchayat members and stuff like that would get these contracts, and then there was the extremely elaborate system of subcontracting that would happen. And that was basically feeding. So for example, during the Asian Games, huge building boom in Delhi. And a lot of that, at least the local materials, were being fed from the ridge. So sand and stuff like that, stone, all of that. A huge expansion of this industry. And so now we're getting into a bit more recent history, and we'll cover the earlier bits. But basically, to finish the mining story, mining was banned in, sorry, I'll go back one slide, just finish this quickly. Mining was banned in the 90s. The justification given for it was environmental. It was basically saying that this quarrying is bad for, it's creating all this dust, it's creating all of these things, it's not good for the environment. So it was banned. But people who have studied this have also argued that there was basically a realization that these mines were kind of getting near exhausted. Basically, with this kind of quarrying, it's just, you just dig down, you dig down, you dig down. Eventually, you hit groundwater. When you hit groundwater, you can't do it anymore. So there was a sense that these were getting exhausted. There was also a sense that Delhi was expanding. Not a sense. Delhi was expanding. Gurgaon was coming up. So this was becoming very valuable real estate. So a lot of deals were being made in advance of basically, okay, this mining is going to stop. Some of it is going to become forest land. Some of it is going to become high-end real estate. So basically, you know, the Chhatrapur farmhouse belt and all of that is in this area. And so it's very, it's a very gray area. So this was done on, for environmental reasons, but the end result of it was a huge sort of farmhouse boom in this area, which the sort of seeds for it were laid earlier. I mean, these deals were being made. People who were running the quarries knew that this was going to happen in advance. So all of this was happening. So, I mean, the reason, like, what I'm trying to show with this slide also is that it's not just a question of, you know, the Delhi Ridge Forest. It's a question of several different uses, which different groups, and often like similar class groups. I mean, you have upper middle class people fighting for this as a forest. You have upper middle class people fighting for this as real estate, and various levels, various interests. So it becomes extremely complicated to sort of detangle who has claims to what. And also you have, for example, you know, some of the Gujar elders who I've spoken to, so like they feel this sense of loss that this has been this land has been taken away with them. They've lost their pastoral livelihoods. They've also lost this sense of being landed gentry, but at the same time they're like hugely wealthy. They just have like tons of money. They have BMWs and all of this. So it's like, but they do feel like they've lost that status because also they're within the hierarchy of elites in Delhi. They don't have that cultural capital. So anyway. Very confusing. But then also they're renting out land on the ridge to migrant workers. Anyway, very complicated. So, and to make things more complicated, this is the list. So the Forest Department has written a very nice book about the Delhi Ridge. It has a lot of material that was very hard to find elsewhere. It also really shows you how the Forest Department sees the ridge and how they want to look at it. One of the nice things they've provided is this table, which I've kind of cleaned up and reproduced, which is all of the government notifications related to the ridge. I'll take another 10 minutes, I think. So,
can you just say what's the difference between protected and reserved forest?
Yeah, so reserved is a more stringent category. You can't do as much. I mean, in a sense, protected forest, grazing is allowed under some conditions. It's a bit more flexible in terms of community use and stuff like that. A reserve forest is very, very strict about what can happen. So, okay, I've already discussed 1913 and 1915. What's interesting? So, a brief digression about the Indian Forest Act. If you know anyway about this act or the Land Acquisition Act, they're very similar in their structure. So the idea is there's an initial notification where you say, okay, we want to notify this much land as forest. Then after that, there's a settlement process where you have to go around. You have to see who lives there. You have to see what claims they have on the land. You have to see, are those legitimate claims? You have to see, are there conflicting claims? Often it's just one person doing this, one person maybe with two assistants. And then they have to, adjudicate on all these claims. And then if there's any protest, counter. So it's a fairly complicated process, as one could imagine. The thing to note about the ridge is that this final settlement has not actually been finished since 1913, so more than 100 years. So when I said earlier that the ridge is a reserved forest, I mean, that's sort of true, but it's sort of not true. So 1942, they redrew the boundaries. That was very minor. Interesting, so in 1944, this is how you get to know it was never... I mean, they won't say that we didn't do it. The state generally won't say that. But in 1944, we'll say, okay, we need a new forest settlement officer for the previous notifications, which suggests that the previous notifications were not actually carried out. Again, in 1958, a new forest settlement officer. Again, in 1965, we need a new officer. So basically...
What does that mean, need a new officer?
So the forest settlement officer is the person who's in charge of seeing who has claims to that land and saying they deserve compensation or they don't deserve compensation. They're like settling those claims to the land. So saying you need a settlement officer is suggesting that the settlement process has not been completed. So it's basically like once a decade you sort of realize, oh wait, we haven't finished this, and we try again, and then it doesn't happen. 1980 was an interesting year. 1980, Jagmohan was the lieutenant governor of Delhi. He was very big on parks, urban parks in Delhi. So he notified 25 different sites throughout Delhi. This was also very confusing because they were protected forests and not reserved forests. Some of them overlapped with the earlier British notifications, but some of them didn't. They were also scattered all over the place. It's like Sanjeevan, if anyone knows, like near Mehrauli, this started in 1980, but not fully reserved, so it was in this sort of gray zone. So this was this sort of intermediate sort of phase where these sites were. Then 86, the Asola Wildlife Sanctuary. Then these last three ones are like the really crucial ones. 1991, the Asola Bhati Wildlife Sanctuary. So basically it was Asola Wildlife Sanctuary. It became Asola Bhati 5 years later when they closed the mines. So the Bhati mines was the biggest mine. Also, there was a lot of protests. So this was a huge labor issue. Unions had been formed. There was Swami Agnivesh was involved with this for a long time. Anyway, there was a lot of press around it, and there's also a lot of bad press. So part of the story of the mines closing was also like, this is like not, I mean, it was basically a headache for the government. And so for them to close this and then to just extend the wildlife sanctuary was like a politically very savvy move on their part. For the first 10 years, it was not, basically very little happened in terms of making it a wildlife sanctuary. There were still trucks coming through. So mining was banned, but trucks would just do the mining over the border in Haryana and they would just come through the wildlife sanctuary. So if you went there in 1992 or something, you would just see like a line of trucks going through the quote-unquote wildlife sanctuary. They cracked down on that later. Now if you go to it, it is actually all walled off and all of that. But the really crucial dates are 1994 and 1996. So there was a big movement to save the ridge, which unfortunately I don't have time to go into because it's also complicated and fascinating and brought a lot of different people together. The end result of this movement to save the ridge was that four portions of the ridge were notified as reserved forest. which is basically what you see here, what's marked in the DDA master plane. These, so one, two, three is here. It's around Qutb Minar. This is actually blue. This is south central and this is south. Anyway, so four bits, and these are all reserved for us. So what's interesting is, so for the British, this was a southern ridge. Now this becomes a southern ridge in the sort of 80s, when environmentalists sort of become aware of this. And again, it's just a sort of process of extension. This is not a ridge, geologically. But okay, you've called this the ridge, it's definitely a ridge. You've called this the ridge, it's sort of a ridge. Then you keep on going, and it's like, okay, it's still the Aravallis. Now the ridge is basically any Aravalli in Delhi, regardless of whether it's a ridge or not. So the issue with this is it's never been treated as a forest before. I mean, the British didn't really imagine this as a forest. It was used basically as commons, and then it was used very intensively for mining. So in that sense, it didn't have the sort of history as a forest that, say, this did or this did. And so basically also in 1994, and then the government basically realized, okay, we have a bunch of villages here, and like, how do we kind of figure what's village land, what is their agricultural land, what is their common land, like which is actually... So the 1994 notification actually said that any government land in these four zones should be handed over for forestry purposes, should be used for forestry. So in theory, this would not involve any acquisition of land or any settlement of claims, because of it, it's all already government land. But even the Forest Department said that actually that was not the case on the ground. On the ground, it was much more murky who owned what. This is in the Forest Department book. They say very clearly, technically, according to the language of the 1994 notification, this shouldn't have involved any complicated sort of land. It was just, you know, the DDA has this, and they just start planting trees on it. But in theory, it was much more complicated. So to deal with the complication, there was another notification in 1996. And I think this is very important because it brings out a lot of the themes that I've been discussing. And sorry to put so much text on the screen, and it's not very nice text either, but I'll just read it out. This is from the notification. Whereas the Supreme Court of India has directed that uncultivated land of Gaon Sabha falling in ridge may be excluded from vesting in Gaon Sabha under Section 154 of the Delhi Land Reforms Act and made available for the purpose of creation of reserve forest. Now, therefore, the Lieutenant Governor hereby declares the uncultivated land of Gaon Sabha's situated in the southern ridge as surplus land and lands at the disposal of the Forest Department. So a few terms here. Gaon Sabha land. So this is basically commons, village commons. I find this very, very crazy. Basically, there's a provision. The Delhi Land Reforms Act was supposed to be like progressive legislation that's trying to give more people in the village. So earlier, it was just the panchayat, basically upper caste who would control the commons. Land Reforms Act, I mean, one of the things it was doing was trying to give everyone in the village some control. Actually, it does a lot more, and I haven't been able to quite figure that out. But for my purposes, it was presented as a progressive land reform law. But it has a clause in it which basically says the government can decide that this village has too much common land. It's surplus. They're not using it. And the government can take it without compensation. They don't have to pay any compensation. What this notification says is the government can take any uncultivated, so ridge anyway is uncultivated, surplus land, and that can be taken over and used for creating a forest. Also interesting that they very explicitly say creation of a forest. So it's not like this is some eternal age-old forest that's crucial to Delhi's ecology that you really need to protect. This is something that we want to take village land, common land from the village and give it and create a forest. And so, unsurprisingly, there's been a lot of conflict, a lot of back and forth about what are the exact boundaries. Also, it's extremely confusing because you have a village, you have the residential area, you have around that the agricultural area, then you have the commons. So the agricultural area and the residential area are not ridge. I'm not forest. So how do you actually mark what is the boundary of agricultural land and ridgeland? Also, you've had so much quarrying. You have all these farmhouses. Farmhouses built before 1996 are grandfathered. Extremely confusing. So also unsurprising that this also still hasn't been finished. So from 1913 to the present day, we're left with a sort of half-reserved ridge. Okay. Very...
Thomas, can you just go back one slide? So how does this inclusion reduce the total amount of...
Sorry, so that's just the additional.
That's additional.
So this 7,000 hectares is like a... actually includes a lot of that Gaunsava land, but then later they realized that actually we didn't specify this. I mean, it was sort of there in the calculations when they were, because they were just, I mean, if you look at how the southern ridge is drawn, it's just all green. But that green has villages in it. That green has agricultural land in it. And on the map, they just make it all green and like, okay, now it's 7,777 hectares. Then they sort of realize, actually, we don't have control over a lot of this land. And also, I mean, the reason the Supreme Court has mentioned is this is a result of a PIL filed by MC Mehta, who has played a very large role in environmental litigation, for better or worse, we could talk about. He is also the reason that there was a huge removal of industry from Delhi in 1996. So the ridge coming up and the industry being removed in 1996 is not a coincidence, is actually the exact same PIL that did both of these things, which is, I mean, huge, huge transformation of Delhi in environmental, industrial, various ways, all as a result of this one PIL, which has come up in court, I don't know, 20, 30 times. I mean, it keeps on coming back. It's like a recurring dream or nightmare, depending on if you like the changes that have happened. Right, so two quick slides. I'll really wrap up quickly. I mean, one is I want to emphasize, when we're talking about the Indian Forest Act and we're talking about, I think it's really important to keep in mind that the Indian Forest Act, I wouldn't necessarily think of it as an environmental law. This is a law for the state taking control of land, whether there are forests on it or not. So they can take something that looks like this, and say it's a forest. They can also, so this picture is Mangar Bani. This is a sacred grove in Haryana. It's between Faridabad and Gurgaon. So now this is not technically the Delhi Ridge. It's not an NCT, it's not, but it is, I would say, clearly a forest by a common sense sort of definition. This is one of the last remaining stands of kind of natural, I mean, I hesitate to use that word, but indigenous species, basically. Species that are native to the northern Aravallis are really thriving. I mean, trees that you don't find on the Delhi Ridge anymore, you could find here. I mean, trees that were probably on the ridge 300 years ago or something and have been, you know, pushed out. But there's been a lot of struggle over how this should be demarcated. And real estate is a huge part of this. I mean, basically it's between Gurgaon and Faridabad, and they're trying to now build up both of these, and also Delhi's obviously there. So there's been a big fight about whether this should be seen as forest land or not forest land. It keeps on going back and forth and back and forth. The most recent ruling was in favor of the environmentalists who've been fighting this. So they're saying it should be zoned as forest, but not as, they haven't made it reserve forest yet. So it's protection, but not as strict. I mean, I think the point with the Indian Forest Act or any kind of legislation is it's not necessarily about the ecology. There's a lot of other factors that come into play. And then this last slide is a question of once the land is made a forest, then how does the settlement process actually play out? So this picture is from Ayanagar, in South Delhi. It's the last stop on the Yellow Line, within Delhi. So basically this is part of that southern ridge belt. And again, Gujars are the dominant caste in this neighborhood. And basically they've rented out land on the ridge to migrant workers. And this is one of the busties that was built there. And basically, it was demolished, I think this was 2 or 3 years ago. But basically, the forest department said this is forest land. And so basically, it gets demolished. The people who are living there, they would pay something to the forest department, they'd pay something to the police, and they'd pay something to their landlords. So for the landlords, I mean, if it gets destroyed, it doesn't hurt them at all. Again, this has been rebuilt since then, since it got destroyed. So there are these kind of cycles of, and this is a whole different kind of politics. I mean, I don't want to get into it since I'm already over the time limit, but one can sort of understand, you know, these demarcations have consequences, but consequences for whom? And these settlements have not actually been completed, but even though they haven't been completed, the government feels that it's within its rights to, say, demolish this prostitute. So the kind of question that I'm left with that I certainly don't have any answers to, but I think if we're thinking about the environment, the politics of the ridge, the question is how can we talk about, because I certainly don't want to make the argument that the ridge is not important, or that, you know, trees aren't important, or that Delhi, you know, shouldn't have any green land. I mean, clearly, Delhi desperately needs green land. But the question is, in what way and where? I mean, why even on the ridge? What is the imagination of it? And could we imagine preserving that green space in a land in a way that doesn't end in this kind of scenario, where next to this you have palatial farmhouses and you have, you know, these huge wedding halls, which are using much more water, which are using much more resources, we're using much more electricity, I mean, all of those things. So that's the question I'm left with, and if you have any answers, I'd be very happy to hear them.